Hello friends, welcome. In the previous video of the recognized organization code, I had discussed what is a recognized organization, what is the code for the recognized organization. I also discussed the principal structure of this code and what is the purpose. And in this video, I will go into the details of the contents. So let's get started. I hope you can clearly see this. So this is what the content page of the RO code looks like. There is part one, which is general, which is divided into six sections. And these six sections together give you the information about this particular code. So its purpose, scope, contents, delegation of authority, communication of information, and other references related to the code. Then there is part two, which is about recognition and authorization requirement for organizations. So if an organization wants to be recognized and get the authorization to carry out surveys and give certification on behalf of the flag state, then they need to follow this particular code. So as you can see, there are terms and definitions. There are general requirements which are there for the recognized organizations. Then they need to have a management and organization system, which I will discuss in detail a bit later. Then it talks about the resources, statutory certification and services, performance measurement analysis to ensure that they keep improving, and further about quality management system certification for the RO and authorization of the recognized organization. And finally, this is part three. Part three is oversight of recognized organizations. And this part is considered recommended standard for the flag administration to keep an oversight over the ROs. So this is kind of like a separate code which is telling you the purpose, scope, references, terms and definitions, establishing an oversight program, then what are the principles of auditing, how to manage, etc. And then there is Appendix 1, which is requirement for training and qualification of recognized organization training staff. And you can see same definitions if you're entering at a trainee level. All that is provided in the Appendix 1. So any information about the qualification of the recognized organization employees, that can be found in the Appendix 1. Then finally the Appendix 2, which is about the specification on the survey and certification function of the recognized organization acting on behalf of the flag state. And this gives you information that you can think of, area of interest covered by elementary modules. It talks about the areas which must be surveyed. And this appendix is divided into scope, management, surveys, and specifications pertaining to various certificates. And any certificate that you can think of which is related to shipping can be found in Appendix 2. Now let's dive a little deeper into the contents, starting with part 1, purpose. The purpose of this code is, the code, it provides minimum criteria against which an organization are assessed towards recognition and authorization. Now that we know the purpose of this code, let's understand who does it apply to. It would apply to any organization which wants to carry out the duties of a flag administration on behalf of the flag state after receiving the authorization and recognition. And secondly, it applies to the flag state which intends to recognize an organization to perform the statutory certification and services on their behalf. And then skipping to part two, which is recognition and authorization requirements for the organization. It starts with terms and definitions in the first chapter. Then it talks about the general requirement for recognized organizations. And this is what I want to discuss a little more in detail. There are 8 points which are mentioned in part two for any organization which wishes to become a recognized organization for a flag state. Starting with the first point, which is general, and if I explain it in my own words, if the flag state wants to hand over the responsibility to a certain organization to carry out this job, then the organization must ensure that it has the capability to carry out the assigned task and has the capacity to deliver high standards of service and its compliance. Then second point is rules and regulations. As per this, the recognized organization requires to publish, establish, and systematically maintain its rules and regulations. a version of which shall be provided in English language for design, construction, and certification of ships and their associated essential engineering systems, as well as provide for adequate research capability to ensure appropriate updating of the published criteria. Basically, second point is about the requirement to have a publication which contains all the rules and regulations of the recognized organization. Then the third point is independence. The RO and its staff shall not engage in any activity that may conflict with the independence of judgment and integrity in the relation of statutory certifications and services. Basically, the recognized organization and its staff must not be involved in other ventures which may affect the independence of their service. The fourth point, which is quite similar to the above, is impartiality. The personnel of ROs shall be free from any pressure which might affect their judgment in performing statutory certification and services. Fifth point is integrity. The RO shall be governed by the principle of ethical behavior, so they must have ethics in their work. Next point is competence, which is obvious. The RO shall perform the statutory certification and services by the use of competent surveyors and auditors who are duly qualified, trained, and authorized to execute all the duties and activities incumbent upon their employer within their level of work responsibility. And then talking about responsibility, the recognized organization shall define and document the responsibilities, authorities, qualification, and interrelation of personnel whose work affects the quality of its services. Thus, it is the responsibility of the recognized organization to clearly identify, define, and document the work profile of each employee whose work is affecting the services that the whole organization is providing. And finally, the last point is transparency, which is very clear that transparency reflects the principle of access to, disclosure of all information related to statutory certification and services carried out by the RO on behalf of a flag state. As per this, RO requires to communicate the information to the flag state. It also needs to communicate the status of ships certified by the ROs along with the information that must be made available to the public. Next section in the same part 2 is about management and organization. And this is similar to your ISM code. There is a quality, safety, and pollution prevention policy, just like the policy statement of the ISM code on the ships. And similar to that, the policy and its objectives must be established. They must be communicated to everyone in the organization. The policy and objectives must include provisions applicable to the statutory certification and services. Make sure that sufficient availability of resources are there. There must be commitment to comply with the applicable requirements. They must conduct management reviews, which include the framework for reviewing quality objectives. And finally, review the quality policy objectives and quality management system for continuing suitability. And as I said earlier, these terms will sound quite familiar when you think about ISM code and compare it with the RO code. Section management and organization. Further, this part talks about the resources, infrastructure that is required. It talks about the statutory certification and services processes, performance measurement, analysis and improvement, quality management system certification, and the authorization of recognized organizations. And finally, part 3, it overall talks about the criteria against which the recognized organizations are assessed, authorized and recognized, giving guidance for subsequent monitoring of RO by the administration. So basically, part 3 is for the flag administration, receiving recommendations on how to keep an oversight over the work of the recognized organizations. Thus, the sections in part 3, apart from the general chapters like purpose, scope, references, terms and definitions, there is a chapter which gives you information about establishing an oversight program, what are the principles of auditing, and how to manage the oversight program. And finally, we have already discussed the two appendices which are there in this code. I hope this video was useful for you guys. If you have any feedback, suggestion or comment, then please do write down below. All the best for your exams. And as always, thank you for watching.